and come together so that as the body of Christ we can nurture and strengthen ourselves for the journey. Welcome. It's a very nice to see you all here this morning, and welcome to those that are joining us virtually. Hopefully, as restrictions are removed, we can get back to a more normal church life. The new normal may be a bit different than the past, but I'm sure it will adjust. I encourage you to follow the church's activities online as things change on a regular basis. The church council has to deal with a lot of issues, not the least of which is complying with federal, state, association directives on how to deal with the pandemic. Tune in to stay abreast of certain conditions. I'm sure you're well aware that Pastor Mark in Maryland is on vacation from June 26th to July 4th. If there are any needs that occur, Shelley in the office will be able to help you. Although it may have been disruptive to many with their outdoor activities, we are very thankful for the rain we've been receiving. I'm sure that the farmers are rejoicing. Bob, go ahead.
Thank you. Now that we're called to worship, rejoice, for God is among us. Give thanks, for in Christ we are a new people. Sing praise, for we come to worship God.
Whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For
For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the Son of God.
I have a challenge for you all. Write a sermon. You don't have to give it, although no one would stop you if you wanted to. But pick a subject and write a sermon. I challenge you to do this because you will find that you will learn a lot about the Bible, religion in general, daily life, and quite possibly a lot about yourself. I don't know who said it, but I have found the quote to be very true. The more you learn, the more you find out how much you don't know. Pick a subject for your sermon. I'm sure you've had an idea for a sermon that you've gotten from TV, reading, conversations with friends, or listening to a sermon in church. Start writing and use the Bible and the internet as resources. In doing your research for the sermon, you will really find out how much you don't know, and it really does increase your desire to learn more. I graduated from a college that required 2 semesters of Bible study. But being 21 years old, a little cocky, I figured I knew it all after reading the entire Bible for that class. Was I wrong? Maturity does play a part in how you learn and write and what you strive to know. You will be surprised how interesting and helpful this experience will be. Choosing a subject can be a challenge. There have been many times that I drew a blank and needed a jump start to get going on the subject. Today I'm going to expand on a sermon topic from a minister of the church that our daughter and son-in-law in Minnesota go to. Reverend Brent Gerber is like a lot of the many ministers that we even have here at Peace Church. It's a second career. He had been a teacher for 8 years. Jacob Proust was an insurance engineer before he became a minister. Marty Black was a librarian. And Lou Worthington had a PhD in information technology before they got the call to be a minister. But after graduating, or as an undergraduate at St. Olaf College, Pastor Brent, who has a very good singing voice, sang in the St. Olaf Choir that is 80 members strong and is in demand for concerts all over the nation. Each year they go on tour, and the choir leader chooses to start the tour at the farthest point away from St. Olaf in Northfield, Minnesota. And then they work their way back home. This particular year they were to start in Buffalo, New York. So the leader told the choir members to dress casually because it was not only going to be a very long day on the bus, but getting up early, packing the bus, stops along the way, and setting up upon arrival, they would probably have been up more than 24 hours. Well, they got to Buffalo that evening, and the church had prepared them a meal, and after the meal, all 80 choir members pitched in to clean up. One of the ladies in the choir took 2 bags of trash out in the back of the church and put them in a dumpster. She set the bags down to put them in the dumpster. She opened the dumpster, threw one bag in, grabbed the other one, and it broke open and spilled it all over the ground. She began picking up the spilled garbage, and an older woman came up to her and demanded that she stop eating the garbage because she would get sick. She said there was a soup kitchen just down the street where she could get some good food. Well, the young girl, knowing that she looked pretty tough after being up 24 hours, tried to convince the lady that she was part of a group that just had a meal in the church and she wasn't in need of any free meals. The lady would not back off and insisted that the girl go to the soup kitchen. The girl finally gave up and said that she would, but she needed to clean up the mess first. The lady left and the girl cleaned up the mess and went back in the church, and she told her friends about what had happened out in the alley. noticed that the girl was sitting alone, looking very sad. So he went over and asked her what was wrong. And the girl said, "You know how it feels when someone thinks you are homeless? That lady thought I was homeless when I thought I was on top of the world, being a college student and a member of St. Olaf Choir." And then she burst into tears. Pastor Brent's sermon went off in a different direction, but it got me to thinking, how many times have you or I misjudged a person? Did we know at the time that we hurt them by implying that they were not the person that they thought they were? Have you ever been misjudged? How did that feel? My son is a good example. He graduated from high school. He weighed 937 pounds. And he weighed 240 pounds when he was a sophomore in college. We aggressively pursued him to get his weight under control, and he did, by getting involved in a number of things, including bodybuilding. He still weighed 240 pounds, but his waist went down to 28 inches and his neck went to 19 and a half. He had the physical build of a professional wrestler. He eventually got involved with motorcycles and became a sales manager for Harley-Davidson. He also began to accumulate tattoos, shaved his head because he refused to pay $17 for a haircut, and grew a beard. Now, if he pulled up beside you, your car, on his motorcycle, with a short sleeve shirt on, and he scowled at you, you might soil your knickers. But what you wouldn't know is that he graduated from college with honors, has a soft spot and cares for a lot of kids and dogs, is very active and is now president of the congregation of the church he belongs to, has an excellent job, was an excellent person, cares a lot about the environment, and is more than happy to talk with anybody about almost anything. Because of his physical stature, no one has ever criticized his appearance to his face, but he knows it happens behind his back and annoys and bothers him. But he is ready to talk with anyone about his choices, and he will defend how he looks. Let's take a little more radical look how you might respond to certain confrontations. Let's say we were in Syria today as a tourist, and we see a man coming towards us, with his face partially covered, a rifle over his shoulder, and a machete in his hand. And he walks up to you and asks if you're a Muslim. Keeping in mind what is happening in Syria area today, would you say, "Yes, I converted to Muslim just last Thursday. Hey, Allah." Or would you admit that you are a Christian and risk having your head off? The Bible says numerous times that if you follow Jesus and heed what it says, what he says, good things will happen. Is claiming that you are a Christian and having your head cut off going to end up being a good thing for you? Our scripture reading today from John says, "Follow me, and I will give you eternal life." Is professing your Christianity worth having your head cut off so that you can live for an eternity with Jesus? Or are you going to lie and say you're meant for the deal? Do you believe what the Bible says about eternal life? Think about that one. Here's another life. Let's say that Jesus walks in the front door of Peace Church, comes down the aisle, and stands here on the steps, and says, "Follow me, and I will give you eternal life." I would bet that every one of us would jump up and say, "Yes, Lord, you can count on me and we'll follow you." But then the Lord says, "You will have to leave now and not take anything with you." Whoa. You have a nice house, two cars, a fishing boat, a retirement account, some savings, and a lot of other belongings, and the Lord wants you to leave them all and follow him now. This might require a little thought. You might ask to have a week or two to think about it. Are you really ready to give up your earthly belongings and follow the Lord? Well, then there's me. For those of you that don't know, I'm a licensed funeral director. I did not work as a funeral director all my working life, but I did work for 13 years after my retirement in the funeral business, and I can tell from my own experience and working with funeral directors who have been in the business for a long time, no one first-hand experience, there are no pockets and baskets where you can take all your things along with you when you're buried. People have been buried with some small mementos, but it's impossible to get your car open, etc. in a casket. There's a story of a wealthy man who put it in his will that he was to be buried with $50,000 in his pocket just in case he had to buy his way through somewhere after he died. He also told everyone that he knew that he was to be buried with $50,000 in his pocket. Well, he died, and a few weeks after the funeral, his widow was having lunch with some of her lady friends, and one of the friends apologized for being rude and asked the widow if she actually did bury her husband with $50,000 in his pocket. And she replied that she did, and all the women gasped. And she said, "I wrote her a check." No matter how wealthy you are, you can't take it with you. In Psalms chapter 48, it says that a person can never redeem himself. He cannot pay God the price for his life because the payment for a human life is too great. So forget taking your wealth with you. I remember seeing the bumper sticker that says, "He who dies with most toys wins." Don't believe it. God doesn't care about your toys either. There's one other word in this discussion that needs to be emphasized and discussed. That word is eternity. Do you have a definition for the word eternity? Do you know how long eternity is? Years ago, when Judy, my wife, was a nursing student at Deakin's Hospital on Wisconsin Avenue in Milwaukee, I used to visit her to stay at the YMCA, also on Wisconsin Avenue. Because hospital schools and nursing at the time required their students to work, I usually had Sunday mornings to myself and would attend the big Methodist church also on Wisconsin Avenue. And Reverend Ellsworth Risen gave the following definition of eternity during one of his sermons. And that is stuck with me all over. This definition is, if a dove from Earth flew to the moon and scooped up some of the moon's surface in its beak and flew back to Earth and deposited the beak full of dirt on Earth, by the time the dove had transported the entire moon back to Earth, that would be the beginning of eternity. I was so impressed by that I have not forgotten it. Plus, I used it when I proposed to Judy, and she bought it too. So there you have it. Life is full of some pretty heavy decision-making that requires a lot of thought and introspection. When you consider my definition of eternity, our time here on Earth could be measured in but just a second, and the balance of time could be spent in paradise if we live that second here on Earth properly. Also, God expects certain things from us before we can expect to have eternal life in heaven with Him. The definition and instructions on achieving eternal life are right here in this book. Life does come with the owner's name. When are you going to start writing your sermon? Amen. Thank you. enter into our prayer time, please keep those who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries in mind. Birthdays and anniversaries should be celebrated with pride and joy, and we all should acknowledge this achievement and wish them continued blessings. Please be aware of all those that have concerns, all the people that are listed in the bulletin have concerns, and we should also be concerned. Those of us who have had issues know that our prayers have helped us. Just think how much more help all our prayers would be as we pray for those, people. Also keep in mind the people that down in Florida who collapsed the apartment building and stuff. What a disaster that has been. And also, keep Rita Trinko in your prayers too. Rita was a former member of our church, was hit by a car over by the grocery store and apparently has had a couple of broken legs and things. Things are kind of crushing. So keep her in mind, please. Holy God, friend of those in need, Jesus has united our burdens and healed our spirits. We lift up the prayers of our hearts for those still burdened, those seeking healing, those in need within the church and the world. Hear our prayers for others and watch over our present lives. Offer suggestions to problems, healing for illness, guidance when lost, comfort when for sadness. Watch over the world which appears to be in such disarray. Guide world leaders to resolve conflict. Help resolve those things that often appear to be petty, but are really tearing society apart, and trying to put more distance between you and those of us that believe. But not only with our church, but all churches, that we may all stand tall and strong and show that following your teachings lead to a more perfect world. Help us to live by the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.